All right, as promised, since we did not quite get through all of our stuff during class today, I'll go ahead and continue through our information as if you were in class, and I'll be posting this up on our YouTube site here for you guys so that you can have that and access that for viewing so that you are through all the material necessary for your exam tomorrow so that we can continue to move forward on our course of events here. We left off talking about Iwo Jima and the Battle of Iwo Jima that exists and occurs on February of 1945. It is in this event actually that my grandfather sees a considerable amount of time, and he remembered that there was, like, he doesn't talk much about it, but what he does say is that there was, like, the island itself was very, very rocky, and so it was very difficult terrain for them to be able to conquer this particular region. And so you would have to, you would go from one little rock outcrop to another, trying to be able to defeat the Japanese. It is in that rock outcrop then that he and two other guys kind of got pinned down into a region, as did many of them on these very rocky, jagged cliffs. And he had, they were taking a lot of fire, and he actually helped to deliver fire against the enemy so the one guy could get out, and then the guy who was injured, he actually put him on his back and took him out. But before he carried them out, because it would have been extra weight, he left their weapons behind, and he actually pulled the firing pins. Up until the day he died, he said that if he was ever to go back to Iwo Jima, which is now known as Iwo Tau, that he could actually find those firing pins under the rock that he left them. I don't know if that's accurate, but he seemed to claim that it would be so. But Iwo Jima was very, very difficult for American forces, and that's largely why when the Marines finally are able to secure the land, Marine and Army forces are able to secure the land, they have to use flamethrowers and explosives in order to do so. Over the course of this, over 6,800 Marines will die, and in addition to that, we will see thousands of other Army men die as well. People say of Iwo Jima that it was uncommon valor, was a common virtue on the island itself. It is where we know of the image, the raising of the flag of Iwo Jima. Now, this actually is not the first flag that's raised on Iwo Jima. It's a secondary flag that's raised on Iwo Jima, but it was a smaller flag, and a photographer was coming around and taking photographs of the different things, and he actually happened to be standing on a box on the top of the hill trying to get some better images of the different area. And when he turned around and snapped the image of them raising the flag on Iwo Jima. So staged or not, whether you consider it staged or not, it was not the first flag that was raised on Iwo Jima. We then began to launch a firebombing raid of Japan itself, led by General Curtis DeLemay. Here we're using a new tactic and a new strategy, a new skill called napalm. Now, napalm is a jellied gasoline, so when it would hit a specific target, that jelly-filled gasoline would basically cause that fire, but because of the jelly quality of it, it didn't burn off quite as quickly, and so as a result of that, it allowed for it to burn and be much more catastrophic to the structures that it was targeting. But it's very dangerous for civilians, and it's indiscriminatory. And so as a result of that indiscriminatory attack, we do see that we begin to, that there is much higher civilian casualty rates because of the use of napalm. On top of which, it's a chemical, and so that chemical does still have effects today for those individuals who worked around creating the napalm bombs, but also in the areas where napalm was heavily, heavily used. It does, however, allow us to target specific military installations and to begin to break the back of the Japanese ability to be able to continue that war production. But heavy winds would often fan the flames, and as a result of that, the fires got so intense that it actually would suck the oxygen out of the air. As a result of specific attacks by napalm, half of Japan's urban area is destroyed and over 80,000 people are killed. But by spring of 1945, when we will invade Okinawa, there is no sign that the Japanese are going to be willing to surrender. And it makes sense when you think about Japanese culture and Japanese heritage. Their heritage is one in which the state comes before the individual, before the individual, then you have the family even. And so this idea of the family name becomes very, very important. And Bushido, or this family honor code, was so necessary to maintain that as a result of that, you could not break with that unless there would have to be something pretty drastic in order for you to break with that. And so as a result of that, the Japanese men simply weren't willing to surrender. Now, the United States needed it to be able to secure Okinawa so that it could be a stockpile base for us, but also it would give us a landing point so that we could come and go back to mainland Japan a lot easier. And so it kind of becomes the last of our island hopping strategy prior to a mainland invasion of Japan, as it's only 350 miles away. But Americans are faced with constant machine gun and artillery rounds, and over the course of the invasion of Okinawa, over 12,000 Americans died. We begin then to have talks with the Japanese emperor, urging him to surrender and to come to an end to the fighting of the war. But Japan is not willing to surrender unless their emperor was able to stay in power. In accordance with the agreements at the Atlantic Charter, we were calling for the unconditional surrender of all of the Axis powers and the leaders of the Axis forces. So we were not willing at that point in time to accept a conditional surrender of allowing the emperor to stay in power. As a result, Japan refused to recognize any argument between the Americans of having that possibility of keeping the emperor in power. But the end is really near. Both Iwo Jima and Okinawa have been defeated. Our military is looking at a mainland invasion of Japan. And now we have to weigh whether or not we're going to invade Japan or not. We look at this and there's an estimate that over 1 million casualties would result in an American invasion. This is civilian casualties as well as Japanese casualties and American force casualties. We knew that we were going to have hundreds of thousands of troops assembled in order to even launch into a mainland invasion of Japan, and we knew that it would probably take months for us to secure Japan. So the idea of a mainland invasion was something that was very, very trepidatious, and our brand new president, Harry S. Truman, who takes office in April of 1945, now has a decision to make. Do we go ahead and invade Japan, or do we go another route? Well, Harry Truman is now given another option in July of 45, or finds out of another option. In 1942, FDR begins under his Office of Research and Development to develop new technologies and new weapons. This included the bat bombs that we already talked about, the napalm that we already talked about, and in addition, it also included the Manhattan Project. The Manhattan Project was specifically designed as the ability to try to develop an atomic weaponry, largely spurred on by the ability to break an atom or the ability to harness that energy, which is given to us by none other than Albert Einstein, a refuge or somebody who left Nazi-occupied Germany. Many of the other scientists that will work on many of these projects also were individuals who left and fled Nazi-occupied Germany and who had fled prior to the war and come to the United States. The Manhattan Project specifically, though, was headed by Robert Oppenheimer and headquartered in Alamogordo, New Mexico. The idea here was if we could explode an atomic bomb, we would wind up saving lives in the end. But the U.S. was spent over $2 billion in the development of it, and there is 160,000 people that are working on the development of this weapon. But the development of that weapon is, there's not a lot of information that's given to any one person with the exception of individuals like Leslie R. Groves and Robert Oppenheimer himself. Most people had very, very little information, and as a result of that, that gave them the ability to keep it more secret or keep it more under wraps. Because there was a great fear that the Russians, even though they were our allies, that they would gain control of this bomb, and then what would happen if they actually gained control of that weapon that would be so devastating or had the potential of that. Remember, the Russians are communist, and although they're our ally, they're only really our ally because they're the enemy of our enemy. So it's not like we have a really good relationship with them or with Stalin either. In July of 1945, we will be able to create, and the team will create actually three different bombs. Each of these three different bombs then were designed in order to try to defeat the Japanese and have the largest amount of impact possible on them. The first of these is tested on July 16th in Alamogordo, New Mexico. And upon seeing the weapon detonate, Robert Oppenheimer sees the devastation that it caused, and he says that I am become death, the shatterer of worlds. In other words, look at what I've done. I don't know if this is really a good thing. And he actually, later in life, says that he regretted actually creating the atomic weapon itself. But scientists still that built it had really no idea how powerful it really was or what would happen, or even if the other two bombs that we had successfully built, if they would actually work, because each of the three bombs was slightly different from each other. But the first test of the bomb is successful. And so we give that information to Harry S. Truman and say, all right, now what are you going to do with it? Are you going to use this weapon or not? Well, when we look at the pros and cons of this, this is what Truman is facing. He's facing a refusal of Japanese surrender. He understands that an invasion of Japan would have to equal somewhat of the D-Day invasion, which could mean a very heavy casualty loss on both sides. Because of the Japanese and because of their fear of Americans, and because of propaganda that was spread by the Japanese to tell Americans that you should be fearful, or to tell the Japanese that the Americans were the bad guy, so much so that when the islands were being taken, civilians on the island, so fearful of being captured by the Americans and the torture that the Americans would quote-unquote put on them, many of them actually committed suicide rather than even as a civilian being captured. There are cases in which women would take their children and throw them over cliffs, and then them themselves actually jump over the cliff as well in order to prevent being captured by the Americans. We estimated that an invasion of the Japanese Empire would take approximately an additional 2 years, which would put the end of the war out in late 1947, approximately. We knew that casualty losses, like I said, were going to be really, really high, and that the leadership under Japan was also trying to develop some sort of a destructive bomb as well, okay? We also gave the Japanese the opportunity to surrender. We gave them that information. We told them that we had a bomb that was unlike anything that had ever been seen in world history up to that point, and that it would cause severe devastation that would rain down on the Japanese people. We gave them a period of time in order to surrender, but they declined largely because we're not willing to accept that unconditional surrender. Those who argued against the use of the atomic bomb, again, argued we didn't know, first of all, A, if the atomic bombs would even work, and B, we didn't know the lasting effects of those atomic bombs, those lasting effects that still exist today, including higher cancer rates amongst the people of those regions. In addition to that, we didn't know how devastated the region would be by those bombs itself. Some other components of that is that Hiroshima and Nagasaki were not major military targets. They were one of a list of like 10 different targets that we had that we looked at as a possibility, but really it came down to finding an area that the weather was clear enough that we could kind of see and pinpoint our location for dropping the bombs itself. We knew that people and civilians would die in this attack, and of course, like I said, the radiation poisoning. The other part of that is, what does that, having a nuclear weapon and being able to use that and implement that, how does that change our world? How does that change our society and who we are and fundamentally alter the scope of history, which ultimately it does alter that. In order to try to get the Japanese people to force their government into surrendering, we actually, in the days and weeks prior to the bombings, We begin dropping leaflets like this. This is one side, and then here is the back side. That basically said, over the next few days, we may be dropping some military, some bombs on any or all of these regions, and that those pictured or those stated, these are the different towns around the outside there, those 12 different cities that are listed, that these would be places that we would potentially be targeting. So we actually tell the Japanese people that they should not only leave, but that they should also get their government basically to surrender. It's really interesting when you look at the language up here. It says that the American Air Force does not wish to injure innocent people. So we're saying it's not against you as a people, Japanese citizens, but it's against your government. And since your government isn't willing to change anything, we're going to have to deal with this. We're fighting against your military leaders, not you as civilians. Part of this is because Americans know at the end of the war, we're going to have to establish some sort of peace with the Japanese people, and it would not be a good idea for us to leave our relationship with Japan as being on a shaky ground. But the idea, too, is that within this, we try to get the people on our side. When we look at the attack itself, Truman will actually send what's called the Potsdam Ultimatum on July 26th of 1945. Again, this calls for an unconditional surrender of the Japanese government, and he argues that if you choose not to surrender, then we will attack using these bombs. Japan simply does not reply to our basically request or forced, hey, surrender or else kind of an ultimatum. As a result of that, then, we will see the Colonel Paul Tibbets will fly the Enola Gay, named the plane is named after his mother, to go ahead and drop the first atomic bomb on Hiroshima. This atomic bomb was nicknamed Little Boy, and that's largely because of the shape of it versus the next one, which was called Fat Man. But the bomb attack on Hiroshima on August 6th, 1945 occurs at 8:15 a.m., and it will drop a bomb that is the equivalent of 40,000 tons of TNT. The temperature at ground zero reaches 540,000 degrees. It will instantaneously turn sand or anything within the small or within the primary radius to rubble. There's literally nothing there. 48,000 buildings are destroyed, and 98% of the city of Hiroshima is simply gone. In addition to the people that die immediately from it, the 100,000 that die immediately, we'll see another 100,000 that die from radiation poisoning that will occur after. As here is Little Boy itself with its uranium core. As I said, the three bombs were slightly different. This one had a uranium core. Our next one that was used, Fat Man, had a plutonium core. And the last bomb, or the first bomb that was used, had a hydrogen bomb. Okay, it was using hydrogen. So we see them change slightly through those three because we really don't know what's going to work. But ultimately, all three do work and have complete devastation. Part of the reason why the landscape in Japan is completely devastated, with the exception of a few places, a few buildings that you see there, is because the vast majority of structures in Japan were wooden-based structures. And so as a result of that, when the heat occurs, they burn up almost instantly. The only structures that survived were those that were made out of reinforced concrete. Everything else is leveled. And so here you can see that again. Some people do survive, but survive with severe burns and then radiation poisoning after. It's interesting to note that individuals would be burned solely on the light flash itself. And in fact, it could cause blindness if you were looking at the light itself. But what we see is individuals who were wearing a patterned shirt, as you can see in this individual here, that pattern was actually burned directly onto the skin. So it's kind of interesting what causes it and happens from that as well. But burns obviously were in some cases much, much worse and much more horrific, and ultimately would lead to the death of numerous individuals. After the dropping of the first bomb, President Harry Truman goes to the American people to explain why we used such a devastating bomb on the people. And he says, "My fellow Americans, the British, Chinese, and the United States governments have given the Japanese people adequate warning of what was in store for them." Again, he's trying to place blame on the Japanese government, not on the Americans or the Japanese citizens. He says that the world will note that the first atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima, a military base, questionable at that. If Japan does not surrender, bombs will have to be dropped on her war industries, and unfortunately, thousands of civilian lives will be lost. He goes on to urge the Japanese citizens to leave the remaining industrial cities immediately and to save themselves. Japan is warned that, again, if you don't surrender, they will face a rain of ruin from the sky. On August 8th, then, subsequent to that, the Soviet Union will declare war on Japan and overrun Korea and Manchuria. Still yet, Japan chooses not to surrender, because they're still being called for that unconditional surrender. On August 9th, then, of 1945, we will drop the next bomb on Nagasaki. Again, finding Nagasaki because of the clearing in the skies. This bomb, known as Fat Man, and if we look at, my image of Fat Man went away. I'll have to pull that up and find that. But Fat Man is a lot fatter, where Little Boy was skinnier and longer. Fat Man is shorter and fatter. I don't know why it's gone from there. But its plutonium core weighed approximately 20,000 pounds, or 10,000 pounds, I'm sorry. As a result of the bombing at Nagasaki, 80,000 are killed instantaneously. It will destroy one-third of the city, and 100,000 people will die later of radiation and cancer. As a result of the dropping of Fat Man on Nagasaki, Russia will choose to invade China. But the United States bids and asks for Tokyo to quit and will finally go to the emperor and go to Emperor Hirohito to call for their surrender. And some of my images here are missing. I don't really know what happened to them. I'll have to figure out what's going on with that. But Hirohito, basically, the United States says, look, you have no ability to continue to wage war against the United States, and your people are no longer going to be willing to endure this and are going to wind up basically trying to topple you and your government. So you are going to have to surrender. In addition to that, we threatened Hirohito with the third bomb. If you're counting and keeping things straight, Alamogordo, New Mexico, Hiroshima, Nagasaki, do we have a third bomb? No. Or a fourth bomb? No, we've detonated the three that we had. But we would have been able to produce another one eventually, but it would have taken us time to be able to produce another bomb. So we did not have it. It was an idle threat, but fortunately for us, fortunately for the Japanese, depending on how you look at it, they choose to accept that surrender. And Truman says, we'll call off strikes for now as long as you go ahead. So on August 15th, then Hirohito announced his decision to his people that he said, the time has come to bear the unbearable. We will go ahead and surrender. And so they go ahead and surrender. Then official ceremonies of that surrender are not held until 1945 aboard the USS Missouri near Tokyo. It's interesting that that surrender occurs on the USS Missouri, because the USS Missouri was one of the ships that was targeted at Pearl Harbor itself, but was able to be rebuilt and recommissioned through the course of the war. Churchill argues that that Japanese surrender saved millions of American lives and about a quarter million British lives. But still, thousands more, hundreds of thousands more would die later as a result of that, because of the burns and the radiation poisonings. And most of the people that are killed under the bombings in Nagasaki and Hiroshima die are civilians. It also causes a dramatic increase in the rate of cancer amongst those individuals. So here we have that acknowledgement of the surrender by the Japanese on the USS Missouri. Okay, and there's Truman with Hirohito there. Interestingly enough, though, when we signed that surrender, although we had called for an unconditional surrender of the Japanese Empire and the Japanese Emperor, the United States allows Hirohito to stay in power. So it's interesting enough here Then on September 2nd, when we sign that surrender and we officially end the war, the United States could have avoided it if we would have allowed for the conditional surrender prior to the dropping of those two bombs. But the United States wasn't willing to go for that and wasn't willing to go to that level, largely because of that Casablanca conference when we said that we would require the unconditional surrender of all three individuals. But August, officially, August 14th becomes VJ Day or Victory in Japan Day, although that doesn't completely, the war doesn't end until the war doesn't officially end until the signing of that armistice on USS Missouri on the 2nd of September 1945. So, and the war is over. If you have questions, please don't hesitate to ask. Remember, we'll have a review session today after school Wednesday, and then we'll have a review session for the test itself tomorrow morning as well. Thanks.